Welcome to Woolooware High School's English Rules, where we look at what we're studying in our English classes. Now, I am missing my helpers, my Year 7 helpers, terribly with English Rules because we're in the middle of a lockdown here in Sydney and there's no face-to-face and it's all online learning. But as the cliche goes, show must go on. Show must go on. Year 10 have started this term looking at William Shakespeare and tragedy. Okay, and in today's episode we'll be looking at, you know, the protagonist or the main character and how their traits contribute to their downfall. Now, William Shakespeare and his peers, anyone else who wrote tragedy during the Elizabethan time, were heavily influenced by their predecessors, and it was the ancient Greek philosopher Aristotle, who was incidentally Alexander the Great's private tutor. He wrote Poetics, which had in it the characteristics of a successful tragedy. So according to Aristotle, the end game to everything was catharsis. In other words, it was this purging of emotions. At the end of this tragedy, okay, you're purged of all emotions. You were in pity, you were in awe, you were in fear of what you've just seen with the protagonist's demise. That it was very, very didactic in the way that it sort of made the audience say, oh, well, I'm not going to do this. I'm not going to follow this protagonist's downfall. I'm going to go the right way. So let's start. The first important aspect we'll be looking at is the protagonists in tragedies were of noble birth. So king, prince, general, noble. You get the picture that these protagonists were from the high end of the socio-political hierarchy. Okay, so the tragedy of the common man was not something that was in fashion at the time. Okay, this came much later in the 20th century. So for example, something like Arthur Miller's Death of a Salesman, with the protagonist being Willie Loman. Loman, get it? Common man, right? But before that, okay, we were, you know, people focused on the tragedy of these individuals who were from the upper echelons of the social political hierarchy. So why would someone like William Shakespeare and other playwrights highlight protagonists of the high end? Okay, and if you look at it, have a look at the protagonists. You have a temporary governor of Cyprus in Othello, you have King Lear, you have Prince Hamlet, and you have the nobleman, okay, Macbeth. Now, why these individuals are the protagonists is that makes their downfall even more spectacular, because our first impressions in the plays are mostly favorable, and this is what makes their downfall even more spectacular. Despite their noble birth, they have a weakness, a very, very strong weakness, which is called hamartia. Okay, it's Greek for sin. Okay, and it's very easy for us to say that, you know, the hamartia is their hubris, their pride, okay, their excessive pride and arrogance. But this hamartia is another weakness that actually feeds on their pride, their hubris. So if you look at, you know, Shakespeare's protagonists, you know, you've got Macbeth. Yes, he's very, very proud. He's got hubris, but you know, it's his vaulting ambition that feeds this pride, you know. And have a look at Othello, for example. Othello, yes, he is proud. He's got hubris, but it's his jealousy that really feeds his pride and brings him undone. So yes, hamartia is very, very important, because no matter how great these protagonists are, no matter how great their status is, this hamartia is their undoing. And it is this hamartia that triggers what we call a peripeteia. Well, I'll say it in Greek, peripeteia. right? So peripeteia is this, you know, this consequence, this sequence of events that happen after this hamartia. So let me give you an example. Macbeth commits regicide. He kills his cousin slash King Duncan, right? Okay, after this point, there's no turning back. And there is a sequence of events that steeps him deeper in the blood. So that sequence of events is his peripeteia. Okay, his peripeteia, his downward spiral, okay? In the same way that Othello, for example, also, you know, you've got the antagonist, the opposing character in the ear of Othello, and his great love for his wife Desdemona gradually or quickly, whichever way you want to go with it, okay, turns from love to hatred, and that's his peripeteia too. In other words, this hamartia triggers this downward spiral that, you know something, we can see what's going on, we have this dramatic irony, but the hubris in the protagonist blinds their judgment, and they just keep on making more and more mistakes. So the protagonist's face controlled by this hamartia and this peripeteia takes them further down, okay, further in this spiral. But you know, at some point, they realize their mistake. And this is called anagnorisis, this realization, you know, that, hey, you know, if I was Othello, I've just realized that I've been duped by Iago, and you know, it was Iago's intentions for my downfall. Can you imagine how he felt? In the same way, also Macbeth, you know, Macduff, Lord, the other nobleman Macduff's C-section birth, right, shows that Macbeth was not leading a charmed life. And you know something, he's going to go down at this point. So, can you imagine Macbeth finally realizing that all these prophecies, all these witches' prophecies, had a double edge to it, okay? So this realization is called anagnorisis, okay? And this is very, very important because the protagonist realizes their mistake and they have to come to terms with it. And by this stage, we, the audience, are emotionally involved with the protagonist. We've seen their downward spiral, and now we've just witnessed this anagnorisis, this self-realization that, you know, they've made the mistakes. And we feel this enormous pity, this fear, this awe about these protagonists who have just realized, you know, their mistakes. And, you know, their end is very, very near, often death, right? And we are saying to ourselves, this could be me, you know, this could happen to me because of my vaulting ambition. This could happen to me as I could become too jealous. So this is where we are emotionally involved also. And there's also a slight other aspect that, you know, the protagonist, sometimes we feel their death is undeserved. Look, frankly, for me, you know, Othello deserves it. You know, he's just killed his wife. I have got no sympathy for Othello or Macbeth, who killed his cousin King and, you know, then orders the murder of so many other people, so many other innocent people, right? But, you know, did Hamlet deserve to die? Or did, you know, I understand that Lear was a bit foolish, or maybe too very foolish, but did he deserve to die and his daughter Cordelia? So, yes, that gets us emotionally involved too, that the main character, you know, even though they showed redeeming qualities at the end, they still die also. So that is also very, very cathartic, okay, for us, the audience. Okay, we feel pity, we feel fear, and we feel awe. So that is the traits of a tragic hero in William Shakespeare's tragedies. I hope you've enjoyed it. I hope I've made it a little bit clearer. Okay, and like I said, We are in lockdown. There's no face to face, but the show must go on. See you next time.